It's go time, baby!
Hello, everyone. I'm Matt, aka Legion Rex, and welcome to a wonderful episode of The Gap. I'm your host. With me, I have my co-host, Shane, aka The Bearded One. How are you doing today, Shane?
Can you believe Ishin is fucking real, dude?
No, I can't. I'm still freaking out about that. We're recording this late. We're recording this late because scheduling stuff. And so we're recording this, like, I think it's been like at least around 2 hours since the SATA play at this point. I'm still reeling from the Ishin reveal.
Can you believe the critically acclaimed Yakuza Ishin game for the PlayStation 4 computer entertainment system is coming to the West finally?
Yeah, we're getting like a dragon Ishin. I'm wondering if that's just for this game that they're doing this just to like let people know that it's not like a main series title, or, and someone brought this up, they're switching over the Yakuza games to Like a Dragon going forward.
I would fucking hate that. I'm not gonna lie. I would fucking hate that. That's so
just
dumb.
Just for consistency's sake?
Because literally, it's the same way I feel about them naming Ishin Like a Dragon when it comes here. Literally none of the other games have been called Like a Dragon, other than Like a Dragon, and that's only because its name in Japan was Like a Dragon.
It wasn't. Its name was like a Dragon 8 something else, so.
Yeah, but they were like, for consistency's sake, we need to keep the Yakuza name.
What if that was their way of switching it over?
As in, like, this is, as in, like, the new shit is going to be called
Like a Dragon.
Like a Dragon, kind of like how Resident Evil is going by Biohazard now.
Yeah, it's got Biohazard now. Yeah.
Hmm.
Well, I mean, Resident Evil 7.
I do kind of love how Resi said, like, it's called Resident Evil 7 Biohazard here, and then in Japan, it's called Biohazard 7 Resident Evil. I think that's hilarious.
Yeah,
I think
funny.
How you do it, Sega.
Just switch
anyways,
the names around.
How are you doing today, Spencer?
Yeah, Spencer's also here.
I am here. I'm good. I made some chicky nuggos in the air fryer.
Damn.
Because I just got back from school about an hour ago.
Them some Tyson frozen nuggies? What kind are they?
They're canes. They're from Costco.
Well, why don't you cane these nuts? Oh, fuck!
Anyways, yeah, not bad. It's very weird. Not having this on Sunday, but
scheduling
sometimes.
I think that's the first time it's like we've ever like missed our date by this much.
If you remember the Blast of Tempest episode, which
okay,
had to be
but Blast of Tempest was cursed. Blast of Tempest was cursed,
and also that because of that, that came out like a month late.
Great episode, by the way. Watch the episode. However, that fucking recording was cursed.
Yeah, it was a mess. It was a whole mess.
My favorite part of that whole thing is that I couldn't make the re-record, so you stitched my previous audio in and created, like, a fucking zombified monstrosity.
I tried my best, okay?
I think that goes in that episode's favor because it makes it fucking hilarious.
Yeah, it becomes an absolute fever dream.
That really is. Like when Matt's like, "So, Shane, what did you feel about this thing?" And then I'm talking about something that you can clearly tell is like completely removed from the actual discussion, and then you come back and you're like, "Wow, that was very insightful, Shane. Great job."
It was the best I could do.
I love considering that.
Good times.
But in any case, we do have a wonderful show planned for y'all today. We have some simulcasts to talk about, some simulpubs, some news, and of course, our featured anime of the podcast, which is My Meta, Revolutionary Girl,
Utena. So, and along, and its movie Adolescence of Utena. So I'm very excited to finally talk about this because I've been, because this is the last show out of my top 10 that we haven't talked about. So I'm very excited to actually have it on the podcast now. But let's move on to simulcasts, which we usually start off on. Now, Shane has finally caught up on the things he wanted to watch. So we'll actually let him take the reins for this one. Because I'm very curious to see what he thinks of the shows that he's seen.
And guess what, bitch? I'm watching anime again. Who would have fucking thought?
Hell yeah. Welcome. Welcome back.
Thanks.
We missed you.
Thank you. I missed you too. So, as Matt said, I've been catching up on some shows that I've missed out on during the summer season, which is crazy because the season ends in like 2 weeks. So yeah, I have like 5 shows to talk about. I'm not going to spend too much. I'm going to go through these pretty quick, but I do have some thoughts. First up, Devil is a Part-Timer, Season 2. This I have the least amount to talk about because it's just more Devil is a Part-Timer. If you've watched Season 1, you know what to expect, except now there is a demon baby involved. So that's interesting.
There's now a baby.
There's a child in the mix, and these things should not be in charge of a infant human life.
How do you feel about the new art style?
Honestly, like, it's been long enough since I've seen Season 1 that I honestly didn't notice it that much. And I don't even mind the new art style that much. I think it looks nice. It looks, honestly, it's giving me, like, Ufotable vibes. It's got, I don't know if it's, like, the compositing or the shading. It's just, it's got those really like sheeny colors, if you know what I'm talking about. Like the colors really pop and it makes the characters like stand out against backgrounds.
Yeah, I get you.
Yeah, I think it looks good. And it's more Devil as a Part-Timer, so it's just going to be good.
Yeah, agreed.
Yuri Deco, the Science Sorrow show, I don't even know how to describe the show to someone who's never seen it.
Now you know my pain.
Yeah. It's like, it's incredibly difficult to actually talk about because it's really out there. All I could say about it is that what if the metaverse was anime? This show, 100%, and I've only seen 3 episodes, so I don't know how it goes in later in its run. This show, 100%, could just throw in NFTs as like a topic or a plot point, and I'd be like, yeah, okay, sure, I get it. Everything in the show is essentially an NFT anyway.
They haven't had NFTs yet, and we're like near the end, so I don't think that's happening.
Bro, fucking Hyperspace and Deco's are tailor-made to be exploring NFTs.
Yeah, they are. I have a feeling it's because this show was being made like right before the NFT shit started up. So I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. We're not done yet. So maybe the end of the season, the plot twist is that it was NFTs.
It was NFTs all along. NFTs were the true villain.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like it. I can't even honestly, I was going to call it typical Science Saru, but even compared to some of their other shows, it really stands out just because of how bizarre and out there the premise is, which is what Science Saru is known for. But even then, this is out there. It reminds me a lot of Summer Wars. Because Summer Wars, albeit the premise and the plot of Summer Wars is entirely different to Yuri Deco, but the general idea of the conflict and, you know, the cyberspace stuff, it's very much Summer Wars-esque in its execution. And I really like what I saw. What else?
Well, yeah, but what do you think of the characters being called Huck, Barry, and Finn?
I still don't know what it has to do with Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn.
Have you met Finn yet? I don't think so.
No.
No, okay. He hasn't. If he's three episodes in, I'm just gonna say that like, we're like almost done that show, and I have no idea what it has to do with Tom Sawyer or Huckleberry Finn. I still don't. I still don't know why that's a thing with this. Maybe it'll make sense once I have the full picture. Probably not, because it's one of those shows that just like, I don't think I'm supposed to understand this. I'm just supposed to vibe.
Honestly, yeah. From what I've learned, this season was the vibe season. A lot of vibe shows.
There's a good number of vibing going on.
Speaking of which, Call of the Night. Finally watched
Vibes.
I finally watched it because the dub came out. Granted, there's only one episode of the dub out right now, so I only watched the first episode. But man, I dig this shit, man. I fucking dig it.
It's real good.
It's real good. It's the entire time I was watching it, just the general premise of this outcast kid who can't sleep, doesn't feel like he belongs in his current situation, just going out in the night to like look for what he needs, just exploring the city at night, the gorgeous backgrounds depicting this effervescent neon soaked city in the dead of night, just bursting with color and life, even though there's fucking no one around. I can't believe I'm about to say this, but I relate to this shit so much, because when I was Ko's age, coincidentally, I was 14, I went on a walk with a group of my friends. It was like, we were having a sleepover at my one friend's house, and we were pulling an all-nighter. It was like 3, 4 a.m. We were bored, but we weren't tired. So we were just like, you know what? Fuck it. Let's just go out. Let's just walk around. So we went out to Ottawa Street. And if you've ever been to Ottawa Street in the dead of night, very reminiscent of this. It is completely void of all life. There's no people walking down the street. There's no cars driving by. It's dead. No sound, no noise, nothing. But the actual street itself is so alive with like the lights and the storefronts and the clear sky with the stars over your head. It's just, I have never in my life been able to replicate the feeling I had when I experienced that. Call of the Night is the closest thing to reliving those emotions. And because of that, this show is weirdly nostalgic for me, because like I said, I've never been able to experience that feeling, like that atmosphere, until I watched this show. It's captivating. And honestly, I know Spencer's had his issues with the show. I know he hates Ko the Weenie. I
just don't like characters that are this fucking Weenie Hut Jr. And I will say, I'm not fully caught up, but I'm almost caught up. I'm enjoying it a lot more with each passing episode. But it's not because of Ko, it's just because I find the side characters to be really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the fuck her name is.
Nazima?
Fucking, yeah, sure. Vampo chick. She's teaching Ko that it's okay to be horny. And that's a valid lesson.
That's a great lesson. It's okay that's to what be this horny, show, kids.
Dude, that's all that this show is about, is that you're 14 and it's okay to be horny.
Yeah, because guess what? You're going through Ko's puberty. Issue.
That's Ko's issue, is that he's like, I don't know how to handle all this. Buddy!
I do not wish to be horny. I only wish to be happy.
Just tell the wenches to silence. Silence, wench. I shall speak to you another day. And then fucking sort your shit out. Show's pretty good. Are you the team? Show
because... Go ahead.
I was just gonna ask. Are you team OP or ED, Shane?
I mean, they're both bops, so
That wasn't my question.
That's my answer.
Okay. Go ahead.
His answer is that he is undecided. He is unsure.
I like that they're both the same group. That's nice.
I am team OP because I love that OP.
OP as well.
I am team OP. I love that OP. I love the show, but like Shane said, because it's the vibes. I think like the more I go, the more you get into the show, the more those vibes change and shift depending on what's happening. And I also really love like the dynamic between Ko and Nazma quite a bit. And it's one of, and I think honestly the show to me is a visual feast. I think getting some of the old Shaft people on this really shows. Shaft have a way of with environments and like their backgrounds a lot. And they've always had really distinct, striking backgrounds. And that's in this, with all of the silhouettes in the background and shit. And you can also tell, and it's interesting that the guy who directed this is, the guy who directed this also did, he also did Vanitas. And yes. There's a lot of Vanitas in this as well. Maybe the guy just likes working on vampires, because he did Monogatari as well. So, who knows? Shane, what else did you watch?
Lycoris Recoil?
Yes, this is the one I want to talk about with you, because I...
Yes.
So, okay, Shane.
Yes.
Did the show live up to the immense amount of hype that I already been praising, that I have been laying upon this show for a while? Well, yeah, the both of us have been laying on this show for like the past couple weeks.
So here's what I'm going to say about Lycoris, or excuse me, Licorice. I hate that. Regardless of my opinions on this show, 100% this gives me 86 vibes. Not because the two shows are in any way similar, because they are not. This is 100% the situation we had last year, where you guys were praising 86 every single week to hell and back, begging me to watch it. And when I finally got around to it, I'm like, oh, this is one of my favorite shows of the year. 100% same situation here, because Lycoris fucking whips so hard.
Mm-hmm. It's excellent. This show is phenomenal. This was phenomenal. I'm really getting an original anime this confident about itself off the bat is so refreshing. I think what really makes this show, and I hope Shane agrees with me on this, is the fact that it's an action show with a lot of really great action scenes and this interesting political like thriller plot that is overly complicated and convoluted in the same way, in the vein that you love. Like this state, like this shit's complicated as shit. But it's also like half of it is just a vibe show with these two fucking cute girls who are just like the most precious things you've ever met in your life. And that's what makes the show, honestly. It's more so, when it comes to the show, I really fuck more with the slice of life stuff. I think that stuff is like where the show really shines and really shows its true colors.
Well, yeah, in terms of quality. Because a lot of what the show has going for it is the character stuff, the character dynamics between Chisato and Takina. They are the anchors of the show. They are the focus. And you can tell. Because 100% this show is about developing their relationship, not only with each other, but with their ideologies, like what being a part of DA means to them, what their job means to them, what their overall goal means to them. And just like the differences in their personalities clashing just makes for some really good character shit.
You've met Walnut, right?
Yes.
Yeah, yes.
Hell yeah.
She's great.
Hell yeah.
The whole squad's great. You know, you have old crippled American man who's like sensei, and he's super cool. You have Mika. You have, you know, Chisato, who's this ball of sunshine. She's the form of like Genki energy that I like. because it's not annoying. It's just positivity. And while there's a fine line, I could hang out with Chisato and she would brighten my day. Yeah, go ahead.
Also, I was just going to say she has Ultra Instinct.
She has Ultra Instinct.
She has never been shot. She gets shot point blank range and it's just like, bitch, moved out of the way.
She gets great. Fucking gatted point blank range with a machine gun. She's like, none of these bullets are going to hit me. And not a single bullet hits her.
She is too good at her job.
My Takina and Chisato have one of my favorite relationships this year in general, just in terms of character dynamics. Mainly because it falls into my favorite spectrum of friendships, where all sense of brain cells go out the window when these two are together. It is perfect. It's absolutely perfect.
It's like what we said last podcast. Like, they are the most intelligent people individually. Get them together, not a brain cell in that room, man. Not a single thought going through those heads.
We're all smart people here, but if you get the four of us together with Brunrit in one room,
we literally learn this.
We have one shared brain cell.
We literally saw this happen at boys' night, where like when all four of us got in the car, we just started making fucking monkey noises at each other.
Ooh. Pretty much, literally though, that's what happened. Yeah.
And it's just that's the sign of a good friendship, where you don't have to pretend or act like you're, you know, all above all this stuff. No, you just make monkey noises because you know that your partners and your boys are going to make monkey noises back at you, and that's just friendship.
Exactly. But yeah, like Course Recoil is like one of my favorite shows of the year. And also, God A1, because this is animated gorgeously.
Looks
good
fucking
job,
great.
A1. What did they make last semester? Or semester? God damn it. Last season?
Oh, I don't know. Just a little
five shows a season.
Just a little indie show. I don't think anyone's heard of it, called Kaguya-sama.
That's it. They did Kaguya-sama.
Yeah, they did Kaguya-sama. Also, the person who directed Lycoris, this is his debut.
Yeah.
Damn.
He previously was a character designer. I think the reason why it looks so good is because he was the character designer for all of Sword Art, all of it from beginning to end, and that included Alkalization, which if you've seen the animation from that, that is not an easy show to design for, because it is exceptionally well animated and exceptionally detailed. So. And you can kind of see all of that in Lycoris, because there's a lot of... The character designs seem simple on the outset, but there's a lot of action... There's a lot of really great nuances to a lot of the characters in this. Mm-hmm.
They're deceptively simple designs that when you, like, look at them for more than 2 seconds, you see a lot of intricate details come out, and you're like, oh, damn, that's a lot more work than any one person should put into anything.
Exactly. But yeah, Shane, what else have you watched?
Mm-hmm. So, all that's been great, right? You know, Yuri Deco, weird, but very unique. Lycoris, fucking whips, Call of the Knights a vibe. But Yakuza's Guide to Babysitting? Oh! Oh, shit. I'm not even lying when I say this might be my favorite show of the season, no cap.
Hell yeah. I love this show. I love this show. The show is like a... It's hard... Again, this is a show that's hard to describe without sounding like a fucking maniac. Go ahead, Shane. Go talk about it.
So it's basically... Yakuza, if Kiryu was forced to take care of Haruka, and then the two of them created the most adorable relationship you could possibly imagine. That's just Yakuza!
It's just Yakuza.
So it's just Yakuza the anime, essentially.
Except that if Kiryu stayed a Yakuza.
Yes. If he never left the Tojo clan. Yeah. Seven times.
No, he left once. Did he left twice.
Did he, though?
Yeah, he left twice. He left during Zero, and then he came back, and then he left... during Kiwami and then never came back. He never actually went back to the Tojo, if you notice. They just,
Mance got involved in all of their endeavors, though.
Oh, yeah, because it's Kiryu. He's the only one who can ever actually do anything.
Every time I try to leave, they drag me back into it.
Man's never allowed to have a break.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Kiryu can never be happy. That is the motto of...
That's what Yakuza 6 taught me.
Yakuza's Guide to Babysitting is great because it's literally just a slice of life show. If every once in a while a person dies,
once in a while a person gets the shit kicked out of them,
it's fucking great.
And just we've been talking about character dynamics and relationships a lot so far on this episode, but the relationship between Kirishima and Yaika melts my fucking heart. Oh god, it's so fucking cute.
I love between this and Spy Family, it's been a good year for like parent-child relationships,
parent-child wholesome relationship depictions in anime.
It's been a very good year. It's been a very good year.
We've been eating well.
And also there was Kotaro Lives Alone was this year too.
Yeah, the Netflix,
and that's
one.
Kind of the same, and that's a little bit different, but it's almost basically the same thing in that, and that's really good too.
Honestly, so, when I see a show like this, I group it into the Poco category.
So Poco, like, Barakamon,
Barakamon, Yakuza's Guide to Babysitting now, Sweetness and Lightning, 100%, yeah. It's just that one subgenre of slice of life shows where you have a very brash, rough around the edges 30-something male who is forced to take care of a small child, and that child changes his entire life for the better. That's my favorite genre of anime.
Literally not a single bad show among them. Just all bangers.
None. All bangers, all peak fiction. I just, when I finish an episode, I not only want to immediately watch the next one, but I just feel good, man. It's just the definition of a feel-good show is Yakuza's Guide to Babysitting.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's all the seasonal stuff I've watched so far. I'm sorry, Spencer, I did not have time for Futopi, but I will watch it for the next one.
I will also be watching Futopi because next podcast is the Seasonal Awards. So
yes, and I talk about it regardless? Do you mind?
I mean, yeah.
Okay.
No, so, well, like,
because I have some shows that weren't talked about. But sorry, finish your thought, Matt.
I was just gonna say that like I'll probably get the Futo PI by next podcast as well. So hopefully I'm busy a lot more lately, but hopefully I get around to it because I really want to watch it because it looks rad as shit. So. Right, you can go. Yeah, go. Okay, you good?
Okay, so I am behind on most shows because of school and all that, but I have three shows that I'm caught up on that have not been talked about. The first one is Bushigirai or Bakumatsu Bad Boys. It's Geno Studios. It's really fun and kind of goofy, but it has heart to it. Has a really cool art style. And is basically like what if we took all these criminals and then turned them into the Shinsengumi? And insanity ensues, and it's about like Japanese nationalist thoughts during this period, because this was after Commodore Perry opened up Port Hope, but before like Taisho. Like, it's a really specific era of Japan, but it's real cool. It's not a 10 out of 10, but it's a solid show, and I would recommend that if it comes up, give it a watch. I'm caught up on Teppen, and Teppen is fucking hilarious. This show is, bar none, one of the funniest shows of the season so far. Of, hell, the year. If you like Manzai, and you like kind of like surreal comedy, this is the show for you. In which you have Manzai acts, in which one of the girls is a space alien whose mother comes down to take her back to Mars. But she gets out of it by making up stories about how her the power of friendship has given her what it has taught her what it means to be human and all of her friends. And she just it's just random stories like the one girl like made beans on toast and she's like, but her having beans on toast taught me that I can eat what I want. And that's the power of friendship. And it's just played like that. Director of Daily Lives of High School Boys, Grand Blue, Sakamoto. So it has that kind of surreal sense of humor. And I can't wait to watch the episode where the Prime Minister gets assassinated.
That's I cannot be believe they are airing that episode.
It I'm is
so happy
airing, and I can't wait.
I'm so,
I might watch Teppan just to watch that episode because I feel like I need to. I feel like it's a must.
Also, you were complaining about the first episode not taking things far enough.
And then episode two took it too far.
And
then
immediately the assassination in the front of the...
But it's wacky. It's very fun, though. It's very wacky, and it doesn't take itself too seriously. It's very good. And then Futo Tantai, or Futo PI, which is a spinoff of Kamen Rider W, which is considered to be one of the better Kamen Riders. Because there are some stinky Kamen Riders, but for the most part, Kamen Rider's real good.
If you've been around for this long, you're going to have some poo-poo iterations.
Poo-poo, stinky, uh-oh, toku stuff. This show rules, dude. This show, Studio Kai, knocks it out of the park with this show. And you don't need to know that much about Kamen Rider W. I mean, if you know basically anything about just toku henshin bullshit in general, you're gonna get the gist of this show pretty easily. Okay. Yeah, you don't need a lot of knowledge. Anything that you go, well, that's confusing, it's explained in the show, but it's completely separate. Well, it's not separate. Technically, this takes place after the end of Kamen Rider W, but you don't need to know really anything aside from toku. There are USB drives that give people superpowers. They can become addicted to those USB drives, and they become monsters. and then you have a total possibility of 9 different Kamen Rider suits. Because...
Oh, yeah.
Because Kamen Rider W is called Kamen Rider W because it's two people in one Kamen Rider.
Yeah, they fuse.
They... Yeah. It... One person acts as the body, they wear the suit. The other person's, like, mind/soul gets, like, fused into the other half of the suit. So they can, like, hear everything and see everything. They're just unconscious. Which has a god-tier scene transition where one of the characters, like, activates his henshin device and, like, collapses. But as he collapses, it, like, transitions from where he is to, like, a rooftop. It's a fucking radical one. It's just... You and Matt and Shane, you guys like toku.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You guys like Super Sentai style, you know, guy in a cool costume does kung fu and martial arts and shit, beats
uh-huh.
up big monsters.
Uh-huh,
you're gonna
uh-huh.
love this because it's that with like some top tier comedic writing. Like this show is funny, but it's also like sincere in it. It's Kamen Rider. And Kamen Rider is known for a tonal balance because it has to keep that. Because when you start to take Kamen Rider too seriously, you realize that this show is stupid and the entire concept of toku is stupid because you're just beating up people in big rubber suits. But that's what makes it radical. and I highly recommend that you give it a look. It's genuinely is a gorgeous looking show, and I have never seen anything else that Studio Kai did, but they knock it out of the park, and I highly recommend that you give her a watch.
Excellent.
For sure. All right. Anything else? Anyone else to talk about before we move on? Or
Cyberpunk.
Okay, I haven't seen Cyberpunk yet, so
it just I am the only one here.
Before recording, it came out today. So
yes,
literally today. Yeah, the 13th. I'm the only one who has seen it. I've only watched episode one.
Ooh.
Okay. So. Deadass, this might be one of the best shows of the whole year.
I mean, it's Trigger, it's Hideyuki Imashi. Like, I think we maybe called that. Like, it's like, How nuts is it?
The thing I will say is that, yeah, it's crazy nutso anime bullshit, but I think the best thing I can say about this show is that it's one of those shows that doesn't feel like an anime. It feels much more like a grounded live-action serial drama. I think that's the best thing it's got going for it. Because it, in its presentation, its production, direction, storyboarding, the way it's edited, the way they use the camera, it all feels like it was tailor-made for live action, but it's not. And I think that's to its benefit, because the story it's trying to tell here, yeah, it's cyberpunk, and there's like cyber-enhanced weirdos who like shoot people's heads off and like travel through time or whatever. It's got the zany bullshit, but all of it feels feasible. Like it has this sense of realism to it, and I think that is partially because of CD Projekt Red, just because it's a world that they created, and anyone who knows them knows that they are very, very good at creating worlds that feel real. And man, and also it's just Trigger, so like top tier animation from start to finish. Just fuck, dude. Oh man.
Do not watch with parents or people around.
Literally not safe for work. Do not watch it in front of anyone. Watch it in like the corner of your room at 1 a.m. with your bedroom door closed, just so you don't have to deal with someone walking.
Oh, not safe for work, is it? Because some of the stuff I saw in the not safe work trailer, I'm like, oh boy, that's some.
I'll put it into context for you, Matt. In the first 5 minutes, not only is there an insanely violent and gory action scene where several people get horrifically dismembered, there's also 2 sex scenes.
Ooh, oh, hell, we
feasting.
That's just
episode one, baby.
We're feasting.
That's just episode one.
This is some devil man shit. And
it's not like that pussy ass, oh, implied off screen shit. No, it is full frontal, right in your fucking face.
Hell yeah. You know, it's like devil man.
Mm-hmm.
Hell
mm-hmm.
yeah. You know, we're feasting. It's not even my birthday.
And honestly, I think another thing I can really credit it for is just how adult it feels. This is, I think, the most adult feeling anime I've watched since Devil Man, because of just how grotesque and hyper violent and sexual it is. It's just, turn all that shit up to 11.
Really got Ninja Scroll vibes from a lot of this, which is a good thing. I was hoping that they just go balls to the wall with this. Imashi is officially goated, right? Like, goated director.
Was there even a doubt about that?
I mean, No, of course not. Dude rules. But yeah, is that everything people want to talk about? Or
that's all I got.
All right, this should be good. Spencer, is that anything else you want to talk about, or are you good to go?
Yeah, I'm solid.
All right, let's talk about One Piece, because One Piece was crazy good this week.
Wait, was One Piece crazy good this week?
It was indeed crazy good. It was crazy good. So some crazy shit did happen, though.
Some wild shit, dude. Some wild shit.
This was the best way to describe One Piece has some of these chapters sometimes where, like, it almost feels like that, like, everything fucking happens, like, immediately.
Like,
and you're just like,
once, yeah.
And you're just kind of like, why not? Like, you're losing it. So basically, in the span of one chapter, Teach goes after Hancock. Teach wants to steal Hancock's devil fruit. Kobe shows up. Kobe gets kidnapped by Teach. Fucking what else happens? Because you get that flashback with Yamato as well in the start. And you find out more kind of like why Yamato stayed in Wano and has actually fixes up some of my issues with that, because Yamato basically was like, yeah, I'm staying in Wano because, like, there's probably gonna be, like, Kaido's, like, men, like, some Kaido sympathizers probably gonna show up at some point, very soon to fucking try to get us. So, I'm like, okay, that makes sense. And Yamato could just eat them, because, you know,
dog.
Fucking, there's so much shit that happened here, I don't know, like, for fucking... So, but, like, the big thing to me is the Kobe and Teach stuff, because this is how Luffy's going after Teach, right? Like, this is absolutely how this is absolutely setting up Luffy versus Teach.
Yeah, right? he's gonna find out probably after the next island, or, like, in the process of getting there, he's gonna find out that Kobe got kidnapped by Teach. And he's going to be like, oh, I ain't standing for that shit. And then he's going to declare war on Teach. Will he? Question. If he does that, what do you think the chances of the Straw Hat Fleet getting involved are?
100. If he declares war on Teach, then they're going to. Because the whole thing is that because it's going to be a pirates versus pirates, which means it's going to be literally a pirate war. Which we haven't really seen. We've seen kind of that in the background, but we've never actually seen one through the perspective of Luffy before, and the perspective of, like, our protagonist.
We've only ever seen, like, skirmishes between different pirate crews. We haven't seen a full on fleet versus fleet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also it brings up the question, because, like, if Teach and Luffy go to war with each other, where do Shanks and Buggy fall into this? Because they're the other emperors.
Yeah.
Do they take sides? 100%. If Buggy joins, he's joined up with Teach just because he hates Luffy.
Yep.
But Shanks is probably going to join up with Luffy.
And Buggy hates Shanks too.
Yeah. Buggy hates Shanks more than Luffy because he's actually worked with Luffy.
Yeah.
So he'd consider working with Luffy, then find out Shanks is on Luffy's side, and I was like, ah, never mind. Fuck you. Does Luffy find out about that, or does he go see Shanks first? Or is there a new island first?
Doesn't he have to deal with fucking Bartolomeo burning Shanks' flag?
Oh, fuck yeah!
I forgot
about that.
That's a detail.
And there's also the stuff with Hancock, because I love Hancock's introduction in this chapter, because she's like, there's only one thing left for me. I must marry Luffy.
Why is she still thirsty for Luffy?
She just wants that cock, bro.
She's never seen, like, a man before. Well, she's seen men before, but Luffy was, like, the first one to treat her like, you know, a person and not an object, pretty much.
So then she decided to become an object. I get it. But of her own volition.
Of her own free will.
Bro. Yeah.
Am I wrong? You're going to look at me and tell me I'm wrong?
Because it's 100% willing and consensual, which makes it okay.
She is doing it out of her own volition. She's a strong, independent woman.
That's why I said she's doing it of her own volition.
I am a strong, independent Amazon empress, and I will be a man's object if I so damn want to.
If she don't chooses it, also, so, Silver's really is really that scary, huh?
I mean, he was Rogers because secondhand.
Rayleigh shows up, and I love that. See, Rayleigh shows up, and Teach is just like, he's like, and I also love the implication too. That I also love what they did, how they expand Hancock's devil fruit here. Because one of the questions I've actually always had with her devil fruit is like how it actually functions. She's basically like Medusa, if you don't know how it works.
Yeah.
She turns people into stone. But I've always had the question on like, can she turn it on or off? They've been very vague. Here they actually finally give a fucking answer. Yeah, she can turn it off. However, if she dies or loses the devil fruit, those people can never ever turn back into person. They stay stone forever.
Let me give context for this. So Spencer, Blackbeard invades Amazon Lily, which is the kingdom that Hancock rules over.
Yes.
And a bunch of Marines show up, and then there's this big scuffle. She turns a bunch of people into stone.
Yeah.
And then Blackbeard's like, haha, that's a nice devil fruit you got there. Be a shame if someone stole it. And he tries to steal it, and she's like, well, GG's, if you take my fruit, I guess all these people are just going to be stoned forever. And then the surrounding people are like, wait, what? And she's like, yeah, if my fruit is stolen or I die, that's that. No one else can turn them back. So GG's, I guess.
And then Kobe shows up.
Well, Kobe showed up before that because actually a lot of his crew, including Helmeppo, got turned to stone. So
not Helmeppo. He actually becomes a cool guy.
Yeah, and then he got turned to stone. Rip.
Yeah, but Kobe's cool as well.
And Kobe shows up and now is kidnapped by Teach due to like a bunch of complicated shenanigans.
So Silver's really was Roger's second mate.
Yep.
Yeah, his first mate. He was his first mate. He was his first mate. And also, Rayleigh is like, what I love about Rayleigh is that Rayleigh doesn't even have a devil fruit. He's just that dangerous.
He's just a beast.
I was gonna bring that up because I'm always curious. So Gold D. Roger didn't have a devil fruit. He was just that busted.
Honestly, I'm just willing to bet that he didn't have one because they would have revealed that at this point, I think.
Because his will was just that strong.
Unless the big twist is that the thing that Treasure of One Piece is like his devil fruit or something like that. Mm-hmm. Which would actually not be a bad twist. I actually think that'd be kind of clever, but I don't think the One Piece. I have a good idea what the One Piece is. I don't think it's that. It's not a devil fruit.
Silver's Rayleigh taught Luffy hockey, right? He's Luffy's hockey teacher.
Yeah.
Okay. And he's just a really scary, busted old man, basically.
Yep.
And even the great Blackbeard is scared of him.
Because he's got the power and the reputation behind him, so literally everyone is afraid of him.
So basically, he's like that kind of old-timer that's been around the block enough that you're just like, yeah, no, this guy will snap you with one finger, don't fuck
with
him.
Yeah, don't fucking cross him if you don't have to.
I see. So now... we have Buggy, who has fallen upwards to the point of being an emperor. We have Shanks, who has always been an emperor. Has he always been one of the emperors?
Has
of the sea?
He always been an emperor, Matt? Like, was he one of the original Shanks? Was he one of the original Shanks emperors?
Yeah, he. As long as we've known him, he's been an emperor. Okay. So.
And then the other two right now are Luffy and is it Law or Kid?
Luffy, Teach, Buggy, and Shanks are the four emperors.
Luffy, Teach, Buggy, and Shanks. Okay, so Luffy is an emperor now, but there's... So the warlords are below the emperors?
Yes.
Warlords are gone.
Well, yeah, they're disbanded. They're disbanded.
Well, the warlords were so the warlords are pirate, are like the ones who could, they're called warlords because they control like one quarter of the sea pretty much. They like have a good chunk of the sea because they just have that much power. The warlord, the seven warlords are basically just like pirates employed by the military. The military ignores their activities so long as they work for them and they say when they need them.
So they're basically privateers. They're like,
yeah, they're privateers, and there were seven of them, and there were seven of them because there were seven of them because seven's a cool number, but also because they had seven in their employee, which was like Mihawk, Crocodile, Doflamingo, and they changed up a bunch, but they're no longer a thing. Their warlords were disbanded by Akainu because of the stuff going on in Wano. Well, not just because of the stuff going on in Wano, but because of because they realized, because the warlords were causing more, because the warlords kept failing because Luffy beat up most of them.
He beat up.
Turns out defeating Doflamingo caused more problems because they're like, well, this is like the third time this has happened, so like maybe the warlords are just a bad idea.
Get him out of
maybe
here. Get him off my payroll.
Who's the fleet admiral? Like, who's the head
Akainu.
Of the Akainu right now? Or Akainu?
Akainu.
Akainu. Yeah. So there's, because he would, so he's the big boss, and then all the rear admirals, like.
Well, he's not even the big boss. There's a guy above him, too. He's like the head of the military section, and then there's like the guy above him who reports to the Celestial Dragons, who report to some guy we don't know because we've only seen him in Shadow.
some dude is pulling the strings, basically.
And he has a giant straw hat in a freezer.
He's got a giant straw hat, and also he has it out for Vivi, apparently, for some reason.
Why? Vivi, like, the fucking...
We don't know yet! We don't know yet. And
Alabasta,
Vivi? How many chapters has it been, Shane?
Fuck, you think I know, man? It's been like 1,000. I don't know.
We still don't know.
But... what I've noticed watching like clips and stuff like that and seeing screenshots is how varying the personalities of the marine captains are, the rear admirals, the fleet admirals. Akainu is just a dickhead. That guy's just a fucking dickhead. Just a dickhead. Aokiji seems like he's, no pun intended, pretty chill. Kizaru is a light man, but he looks like a fucking Yakuza boss.
And he's something.
Who's the blind guy that controls
Fujitora.
Gravity? Fujitora seems like he's like an old style captain, you know, like he's just chill.
He's the guy. If you just don't bother him. And like aren't around when he's not gonna give a shit about you. Like, he only deals with you if you're actually a problem. If you're a pirate but not causing any problems, there's no reason as to why he should go after you. Like, he's not gonna bother you.
And then Garp is Luffy's grandfather.
Garp is my boy. I love Garp.
Garp is the G.
Isn't he just like a typical grumpy old man, but he's also really
powerful?
He's not
grumpy, he's like actually like a really like...
He's not grumpy? I thought he'd totally be
He's a little grumpy, but like he's like he's more upbeat than you'd expect him to be.
I always expected him to be like upset that, you know, Luffy and Ace and Sabo like took the path they did.
Well, like he says in the manga that like, yeah, he's maybe a little disappointed that they're not like marines like he is, but at the same time he still respects them for following their own path and
what a good
chasing
grandpa.
Their dreams.
Oh,
he's
wait.
a D. He's like he's a D, so he's inherently he's inherently for that kind of stuff, so
yeah. Freedom and all that, and then
we spent a lot of time talking about One Piece, and I think we should probably move on.
We should probably move
else.
On. Yes,
I was gonna say we can move on. I ask questions, and I will, and I'll totally talk about One Piece because I'm not reading My Hero anymore. So,
yeah,
I refuse until somebody tells me that they fix it because.
Just like Ed Shot's fixing his heart right now. Oh, got him.
So, yeah, maybe we should explain, because last episode we talked about, you guys mentioned...
We talked about the spoilers, and they turned out to, and it turns out the spoilers, and yeah, so, like, we didn't, we already kind of discussed it.
Yeah, yeah, we 100% discussed it. It's 100% the dumbest thing I've ever read. It is, it makes zero sense.
Yeah, and how do you feel about Horikoshi possibly killing off three people to bring back Bakugo?
Of course.
I mean,
I'm just saying, you know, of course, because we can't have anything bad happen to Bakugo. He's one of, like, three characters that we actually care about.
Like, Mirko I can get because she was already, and, you know, going up against Shigaraki to fend him off in her state. Yeah, okay, that makes sense. Edshot and Genus, though, it's like, that's a bit much, especially with, you know, the ass pull you just gave us with the Edshot becoming his fucking heart thing.
You don't understand, Spencer. He gave him his heart.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Ah, yes, yes. But sickos. How much longer do you think this is going to go on before he inevitably cuts over to something else and stays there for like 10 chapters?
I mean, he already kind of did that. He already cut away from it. So, yeah, probably next chapter, honestly.
Because they still got some others.
Where the fuck is Deku? Deku was supposed to be on his way.
Dead. I killed him. He died.
He got hit by Deku, a fucking jetliner.
Deku is actually being brought back from the dead right now by throws dart at dartboard. The tree
Kamui
guy.
Woods.
Kamui Woods.
Yes. You know what? I'd be more fine with that. Kamui Woods is my boy. I feel like that would. I have emotional attachment to Kamui Woods. I love that.
Okay.
Man.
How the fuck, Shane, did we both go to Kamui Woods?
Because he's the
brain
boy,
cell, man.
I love
the
that.
Brain cell.
I love that,
it's
man.
The brain cell.
Is Kamui Woods like top tier background character?
Yes.
Yes.
Because he's fucking great.
He's hitting Mount Lady.
He is
the fucking
lucky motherfucker. Love that man.
I can't wait for Horikoshi to fucking bring in Vigilante's characters.
I feel like that may or may not happen. I don't know at this point because like Shigaraki is like fucking uber level powerful. He's like an Omega level mutant from X-Men. He's just like, how the fuck do you fight this guy?
Here's the thing I've learned in the wake of the Edshot phenomenon is that I'm literally never going to predict what's going to happen next. So why bother?
This is why I want Horikoshi to write a horror manga, because I feel like his ability to make random shit would actually work exceptionally well in horror. Also because imagine his artwork with horror. I'm just like, so,
you know, I would have been more okay with him fucking gaining the powers of All for One than this.
I'm pretty sure the only reason he's not doing that is because he used it on Heroes Rising.
He used it on the second movie and went, yeah, I hope I don't need to use this in the future.
Well, because he openly stated that it was that was going to be the end of the manga, but he changed his mind like sometime around the time he started writing Overhaul. So like he changed his mind. I think like around the time Overhaul was being written, he changed his mind. So he just like, well, I like this idea and I don't want it to go to waste. So let's just put it into Heroes Rising. So we have it out anyways, because I'm not going to use it.
He's not going to use it. I mean, yeah. Hey, it's a great movie. It's probably my favorite of the three movies.
With that animation, so...
Yeah. And it actually felt like it was a team movie instead of the other two that weren't team movies.
Two Heroes is kind of a team movie. It's just between Deku and All Might.
But,
and I don't mind World's Heroes Mission being... a not team movie because it has like a different kind of a different vibe, different kind of antagonist. So,
and also it's kind of mid.
It's also the most mid. But Shane, have you read the new Chainsaw Man chapter?
I have. It's fucking stupid.
This
is the dumbest manga ever made.
This is a Joker chapter.
And yet it's the greatest work of fiction quite possibly ever written.
This is the dumbest manga I've ever written.
People pay Denji 10 yen a minute to become a chair. No, 10 yen for 10 minutes to become a chair.
Can you believe that like two chapters ago we had this gnarly, insane fight scene where there was like blood and gore everywhere, like intestines ripping out of fucking demons' guts, and now here we have the horny lad getting paid to have women sit on him because he wants to be found out so he can get a girlfriend. It's crazy.
That's my favorite point. Shit part, Shane, is for no altruistic reason. Denji has never been altruistic. He's just kind of helped people because, you know what, why not? But his main and only goal is to get a girlfriend. And his last girlfriend turned into a toddler at the end. So,
yep.
So now, and the best part is that he fucking blows it. He blows his cover, and the woman's just like, "You're a fucking loser. Shut the fuck up.
You're a fucking idiot.
You are dumb." And the guy's just like, "Dude, nobody's gonna believe you. You don't look like a chainsaw man. You don't act like a chainsaw man. You are pathetic."
Now, see, if I was in that situation and she turned away after calling me a fucking moron, I would have been like, "Had jokes on you, bitch."
I would say, "Pull the ripcord." Yeah.
Yep.
Chainsaw Man rules in the fact that Fujimoto knows exactly how to do, you know, two chapters ago, this radical looking fucking fight scene with a cockroach demon. And now he's just drawing his main character as a chair.
Being a simp.
Okay. And I've been a submissive. That's what he's been. Do you think Fujimoto just doesn't plan out his storylines? Does he just write?
Seeing as the man on the regular tries to levitate, I would assume not.
He doesn't he just draws, and it's just like, this is the chapter today.
I can 100% see Fujimoto sitting at his desk, like penning this shit out and being like, "This is sick, dude."
He is 100% the kind of man that, like, after he finished, he looked at it and went, "People are gonna fucking love this."
100%. That's how it goes.
I am a genius.
This is a man who regularly pats himself on the back,
as he should, because he's great.
Yeah, but I think Fujimoto's story is he has an A and a B, and he doesn't fucking care how long it takes to get there. He just will write whatever the fuck he wants.
He doesn't give a shit how long it'll take to get there, what the fuck happens in between. Who gives a shit?
Who cares? Eventually, you're gonna get some radical shit for like 10 chapters. It's gonna melt your brain, and then you're gonna be back to Denji rescuing a cat so he can get laid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bitches love cats.
Bitches are pussies, and pussies are cats.
Therefore, I eat
perfect.
Okay.
All ergo, right. Vis-a-vis, women are cats.
Are we done?
All right, let's go to news.
Let's talk about how Netflix is adding a bunch of interesting anime. So Netflix recently made a deal with Nippon TV, which, if you don't know who Nippon TV is, it is a station in Japan that is very much well known for airing for its anime block. So they have aired lots of different shows in the past.
Noitamina?
What?
Is that the animation block? Is that animation backwards? That animation block, is that Nippon?
I don't know. I don't know the specifics. Let me check. No, it's NTV.
It's NTV. Yeah.
Okay, so, Nippon TV announced on Monday they've entered a partnership with Netflix. We'll add 13 of Nippon TV's anime titles to the streaming platform in a multitude of countries. This is not just Japan. This is, like, basically global.
But Netflix will add the first 38 episodes of the 2011 Hunter x Hunter television anime in 104 different countries, Oranheim High School Host Club in 190 countries, and Claymore in 136 countries on September 1st. Some of these we already have here. Like Hunter x Hunter, we already have on Netflix. Can someone do a quick check for me and find if Oron and Claymore are on Netflix now?
I'm on because, it.
One second.
Because Oron, I don't know if Oron was already there, and I know for a fact that Claymore wasn't there.
Oron High School Host Club.
We do not have Claymore.
We have Oron, though.
All right, we have Oron. Okay, but here's what's interesting. Here's what's interesting. Some of the titles that they have are interesting. Listen to this. The following titles will stream on Netflix in a later date. These include Death Note, which we already have.
Yeah, we have.
Death Note Relight 1 and 2, which are the recap specials for Death Note. From Me to You, which is Kimi no Todoke, both seasons of that. The 1997 Berserk. Parasite the Maxim. Nana. Hajime no Ippo. And Monster. Now, so some of these names are kind of big, because they have not been available. I say kind of because they're actually very big, but we haven't had these for legal streaming. A lot of these for legal streaming. Nana is available on High Dive, and as recently has been available for High Dive. The big ones, honestly, to me are Berserk 97 and Monster. Those are not available for legal streaming anywhere, as to my knowledge.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but Berserk 97 has never been made available to stream anywhere before.
Nope.
Am I correct?
No, it was owned because it was on the unfortunate position of being licensed by fucking Media Blasters, if you remember them. And the license expired in 2012, which was right before the onset of streaming, like right before. Like Crunchyroll was definitely around during 2012,
but it was nowhere near as big as it is now.
Yeah, it was definitely around. But yeah, so like it's definitely like they lost the rights around then. And Berserk obviously has been taken, like, in terms of the stuff that is available for legal streaming, it's the recent Golden Age Arc movies, as well as the 2016 CG series, which covers the arcs after Golden Age. This series, which is the 97 version, which covers the original Golden Age much more in-depth and is widely seen, including by myself, as like the definitive adaptation of Berserk despite its issues and despite some of its age, is like it's never been available for legal streaming. And I feel like that this is actually kind of, I hope that it comes here, because this is a show that this is the version of Berserk I always tell people to watch, because I think it's fucking excellent. I think it's a fantastic adaptation of the source material. Monster, I'm also very excited for, because that's another one that's haven't been available for legal streaming. Because unfortunately, Monster is bizarre, because Monster is fully dubbed, and it's fully it's like got a fully dubbed release, but never actually in physical form. Monster was in North America only had one 13 episode volume that sold so poorly that they just canceled the other releases. The rest of it was never released. However, the entire dub has been aired on TV multiple times on Toonami as well as on the Sci-Fi Channel. And so like the dub exists, it's out there and you can find it in its entirety. And it was on Viz's website at one point for the whole thing, but it's been since been removed because Viz doesn't have its own web streaming platform anymore. Remember when they had that? Because it was like 2012, and nobody cared. That's how I watched Blue Exorcist. It was on their service. It was garbage. it was garbage. Like imagine buffering at the speed of like molasses. But I hope it comes, because Monster, is an incredible fucking series and deserves and deserves to be legally streamed, frankly.
Yeah. It is a pretty long one. It's 74 episodes, but it's incredible. It's one of my favorite anime ever made.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Speaking of anime we really like, One Piece again.
Because we actually have some
genuine news about One Piece, and that's when One Piece is coming out here in North America. We actually have release dates now. So let's read on. Crunchyroll announced on Monday that it will release the One Piece Film Red anime, both English subtitled and English dubbed, in the United States, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand in November. The film will open in United States and Canada on November 4th, and tickets will go on sale on October 6th. So put that date in your calendars, so that way you can pre-order tickets, because these things are going to sell out like a motherfucker instantly. In addition, Crunchyroll Expo Australia will host the subtitle premiere on September 16th, followed by the North American premiere in New York on October 6th, which is the first day of New York Comic Con, which is also the first day that Bleach premiering. Imagine being a Shonen fan going to New York Comic Con and going, I'm watching Film Red and the first episode of Thousand Year Blood War back to back.
Jesus Christ.
Imagine being, you know what? We should go.
The nostalgia.
We should go, Shane.
We should just cop some tickets to New York Comic Con.
Let's do it. Let's fucking do it.
Yeah, so I'll leave you guys to decide on tickets. And I will be your transportation.
I am very excited for this, and I think it's going to be great. There's a new trailer. There's an official trailer from Crunchyroll out, and it's a dubbed trailer, I'm pretty sure.
Yep.
Oh yeah. And also, we're gonna see this dubbed, right?
The funny dub for One Piece is like insanely good. So yes.
Yeah. It's god tier, and I would be really lost if we went to see it subbed and I listened to Grandma Luffy.
Put some respect on her name. She's great.
Hey, no, she's great. However. Just like Goku, it would be completely confusing for me because I have not heard Goku as anything but Sean Schemmel. So
you imagine watching if you watch Superhero in Japanese, because Gohan is voiced by the same person
and Goten.
Sorry, what?
And
it's
Goten.
The same woman.
She also voices all of them.
Yeah, she also voices Bardock and Raditz. Is she the voice of Raditz? I don't think so.
No, she's Turles.
She's Turles. Yeah, she's Turles and Bardock Black as well. Yeah.
Who's Bardock? Who voices Bardock?
Sonny Stray.
In English, it's Sonny Stray, yeah. And sounding exactly like Sonny Stray. He doesn't really change his voice very much.
Doesn't he also do Piccolo? Or no?
Krillin.
Piccolo is
Krillin, he just kind of like he raises the pitch of his voice. Hi, it's me, Krillin.
True.
What?
Damn. But I should audition for the new Krillin, dude.
It's me, Krillin. Funny, Goku. I turned him into a sensu bean. Funniest shit I've ever seen.
Okay, we're moving on.
Speaking of our final piece of news is a new piece of news that I found interesting, mainly because of the show we're covering today, actually has its roots in this, and I think that the fact that this news dropped during the time we were watching this, I think it's just exceptional irony. A website opened on Wednesday to announce that Ryoka Ikada's The Rose of Versailles manga is inspiring a new anime film. Ikada drew an illustration with a message half-jokingly commenting on the fans not forgetting the previously announced 50th anniversary Rose of Versailles exposition at the Tokyo City View Observation Deck will preview the teaser visuals with some of the character designs and background production art starting on September 17th. Ikada serialized the original manga in Suesa's weekly Margaret magazine from 1972 to 1973. The story of Love and Destiny is set in the intrigue-filled court of Queen Marie Antoinette before and during the upheavals of the French Revolution. Lady Oscar is a young woman raised as a man to serve in the palace guards. Udon Entertainment began releasing the manga in December of 2019 and the entire manga is actually now, for the first time in a, like, I think ever, really is available in 5 omnibus volumes that you can now buy. The manga inspired also inspired a 40 episode anime in from that aired from 1979 to 1980 that Right Stuff eventually released in North America in 2013 with two DVD sets. They have now also been upgraded. There's also an HD remaster of the series that Discotech released that's on Blu-ray and has came out on April 2021 and in June of 2021. So you can go watch the original anime. I have seen Rose of Versailles. It's a show that I watched a while ago, and it was one of my during an time where I wanted to go back and watch a lot of older shows. Rose of Versailles still stands as one of the best older shows I've seen. I think it's really great, and it pretty much defined every shoujo series that came after it for like two decades. Its character design, basically, if you saw the character designs in Utena and were like, "Huh, that's shoujo as fuck," it's because of this. They look exactly like.
Apparently, it's not. According to Wikipedia, Ikuhara has denied on several occasions, including the director's commentary on the final DVD, that it was inspired by Rose of Versailles. It was apparently...
I mean, it probably wasn't, but, like, if we consider the fact of, like, how influential Rose of Versailles actually fucking was...
Yeah, oh yeah, 100%.
I feel like that even... He can deny it all he wants. He can deny it all he wants, and I believe him. I don't think he used it as a baseline, but let's be honest here. He very clearly based it on shoujo manga at the time, or at the very least that genre.
Basically Rose of Versailles.
Which is basically Rose of Versailles, because the whole thing, because Rose of Versailles follows a similar premise. It's literally about a woman posing as a man who falls on, posing as a man. Like, it's all there. It very much, it's very much in a similar vein. And it's a complicated, and it was a massive, huge deal at the time, and it was a huge game changer for shoujo manga because it was. Because it was involved with a bunch of other stuff. Also, Ryoka is like the author of Chihaya Furu, a member of the Communist Party of Japan. Exceptionally based.
We stand.
We stand Japanese communists.
She was a philosophy major and was a member
that
of
explains
the,
a lot.
Yeah, and then dropped out to be part of the Japanese New Left.
That explains a lot.
Yeah. But I really love Rose of Versailles. If you've not seen it, I highly recommend you check it out. The show is like 40. The show is 40 episodes. It's like a quick watch. It's really great. It's one of the best shows of the 70s for anime. Just easy. Like it's up there as like one of the best from that time. So now, speaking of that, which we can move on to our featured anime of the podcast, which is, as I've mentioned, one of my favorite shows, Revolutionary Girl Utena, which is directed by Kunihiko Ikuhara and written by Yoji Inakito. And it's from Studio JC Staff, if you could believe it.
Fucking crazy.
And it originally aired for 39 episodes from April 2nd, 1997 to December 24th, 1997. And it's currently licensed by Nozomi Entertainment. And they have it for legal, and it is available for legal streaming on Funimation, I'm pretty sure.
Okay, so the streaming stuff for this show is very interesting because the TV series, Revolutionary Girl Utena, is available in its entirety, sub and dub, on both Crunchyroll and Funimation. However, the movie
and
YouTube on Nozomi's official YouTube channel. However, the movie Adolescence of Utena is only legally available to stream on Funimation and Retro Crush, which is a free with ads streaming site for like really obscure classic anime.
Mm-hmm.
But the movie's not on Crunchyroll, so.
Yeah, the movie's not on Crunchyroll. The show has been released by Nozomi in three box sets that cover the entire show and the movie. So you can go pick it up and it's a Nozomi release, so it's top tier shit. It's a really great. It's a really good release because it also comes with a bunch of extra shit for a cheap price. So Revolutionary Girl Utena follows our lead character, obviously, which is Utena Tenjo, who after her parents died, is visited by a prince who gives her this rose engraved ring, and promises that they will meet again. Utena is so inspired by this that she wants to become a prince just like said prince. This search leads her to Otohori Academy, where she enrolls as a student and unwittingly kind of ends up in a dueling tournament with the student council, because all of the members wear signet rings identical to hers, and she gets involved in basically the equivalent of like a War of the Roses kind of situation. Basically, imagine War of the Roses if it was with student council members. Lots of drama that ensues from here. But there's also a lot of other stuff going on with Utena, because Utena is a very complicated show to discuss. Mainly because so much of it is clouded in a lot of surrealism and trippy, weird visuals. Both Shane and Spencer have had experience with Ikuhara in the past. They have both seen Sarazanmai, which is a great introduction to Ikuhara. However, it is also, as I like to put it, baby shit. Because I am an enormous fan of Ikuhara, and I know how weird he can get. And Utena is my favorite of his shows, and I know Utena gets so weird. And Shane, how did you feel about Revolutionary Girl Utena? How did you like it?
I don't even know, man. Like, in a single word, I think you summed it up pretty damn well. This show is complicated. Like, this is a work from a man who clearly had a vision for what he wanted this show to be. I can't make heads or tails of it half the time, but hey, that's okay. That was his intention, so it's all good. It's extremely complicated. It has very difficult to decipher themes. It's got a lot of symbolism and very avant-garde visuals. A lot of it is... it's a bit much, to be honest. But I will say that it is exceptionally well made, from its direction to its writing to how it utilizes those themes and evolves them throughout the course of the show, the way it uses its framing to symbolize those themes and different aspects of its characters, the characters themselves, and how extremely complicated, three-dimensional they are. It's just a banger, dude. From top to bottom, certified banger. But you know, you've got to be dedicated to this show. You got to be in it for the long haul. You got to be ready for a lot of weird shit. You know, a lot of. I'm trying to think of the word. Just a lot of shit, man. You just got to be ready for it. There's a lot to this show. There's so much under the surface that you've got to watch out for.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like you mentioned, the long haul. This show's 39 episodes. So it's not short. It's not. It's kind of like say to yourself, I'm going to watch this and like actually commit to it. Spencer, what did you think of Revolutionary Girl Utena?
This show exists.
It does exist. It is a
it
show.
It exist. Is a show that
it
exists.
It is a show. It has moving pictures. It has a director, producer, writer, music. God, this is a fucking weird show. Like to say that this is postmodern would be an understatement.
This is postmodern to postmodernism.
Yeah. This is constantly playing on common shoujo tropes and just, it is the Neon Genesis Evangelion of like shoujo bullshit. Like, like, in more ways than one, it is a mirror image of, like, Ava. And it makes sense when I read that Anno and Ikuhara are good friends. Because, you know what?
Pals, dude.
I think it's interesting. Yeah, I think it's interesting, too, that both that when there's a award known as the... there's an award known as the Animation Kobe Award, which isn't given out anymore. But it was originally given to shows that they considered to be exceptional and was widely seen as like the best shows of the year. Both Ava and Utena won this same award at the time. And so it has that same vibe. And what's interesting about, like, you mentioned the similarities to Ava, I do think that they're like obviously it's very different in a lot of ways, but I do think that there is some, to an extent, Utena did for like shoujo and magical girl stuff, that what Ava did for Mecha, because Utena kind of changed the game onto what a magical girl show could be. It just didn't do as well as Ava. Which kind of stopped it in its place a little bit. But I do like the fact that it does deconstruct so much. If it takes the idea of, like, the normal idea of the magical girl, which has the transformation aspect, and really applies that to be like, okay, no, like, what if, like, the person transformed, like, literally wants, like, to become a different person? And it's really great, and because it's in the realm of surrealism, you can buy it, because it's in the realm of surrealism. It's in the realm of, like, basically anything can happen. This is a show where, like, a guy has a stopwatch because, yeah. So, like,
what does that stopwatch mean, Matthew?
Okay, it's what you want it to be. What do you think it means?
I think it means that fucking Mikey, like times how long it takes people to figure things out.
I've always seen it as that he's unable to, like, that he's unable to tell time himself. He's unable to really relate to people. So he uses the stopwatch as a way to track people, like when conversations end or when, like, people respond and shit. My, so it's his way of trying to...
My favorite thing about that stopwatch is when... Oh, God, who was it? The chick that appears as a cow in Adolescent.
Mm-hmm. Nanami.
Nanami,
yes.
When Nanami is just like, what, why do you have that stopwatch? What does it mean? And the show just keeps moving. It just doesn't.
Exactly. It's great.
I feel as insane as a woman who lays an egg and becomes a cow.
Yeah, because it's hilarious. Yeah, because, you know,
it's
why
hilarious.
Not?
Hilarious. Because the show makes no sense.
My feeling when those are two separate things that happen to the same character.
The same character. And I mean,
in different episodes.
Yep.
The show also is separated into, like, really easy to understand, like, sagas. Like, there's four sagas in the show, and they're really easily separated because there's a recap episode at the end, basically, of that saga that leads into the next one, and it's just really, really well put together. But the show makes no goddamn sense, and I loved every second of it.
It's a vibe. It's a vibe. You're not supposed you're not supposed to understand it.
I'll tell you what I vibe to. That grade A fucking soundtrack that I'll talk about later. Because we got to do favorite, least favorite, best episode, all that fun stuff. So we'll talk about it later. But okay, go ahead.
Yeah. What's your favorite episode, Shane?
Okay. Speaking of Nanami, my favorite episode, and I, there was a good amount.
It's
not the egg. There was a list of favorite episodes, because there's a lot of really good episodes in the show, particularly near the end. Like, I would say the last 10 episodes are all in contention for best episode, but I can't deny myself the fact that my favorite episode, the one I easily had the most fun watching, was episode 8, Creed High Trip.
Oh my god, that fucking episode.
This is a fun one. This is a fun one. Now, there is some... The fun fact, this was supposed to be episode 6, mm-hmm. But episode 6 took too long to make, so they switched out the episodes because they were making them out of order. So episode 6 and 8 are supposed to be switched around.
Yeah, and apparently that led to some, like, brief continuity errors, which I didn't notice because I was laughing too hard at the elephants.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. This is a great episode because it's literally just it's Freaky Friday.
It's Freaky Friday with lesbians, man.
Very funny. The best part was every time those elephants showed up.
Fucking elephants, dude.
The fucking elephants. I forget, weren't they like, didn't they run off a cliff at one point?
Nanami and her entourage were climbing up a mountain, and then they look up and there's just a herd of elephants falling off the mountain towards them. It's so funny.
I could also swear that at one point they were in, like, the elephants were in, like, a car or something, or like they came out of, like, fucking stage right.
Yeah, they were driving their little buggy through the jungle, and then the elephants enter stage right, just like blasted them off into space.
It turns out that the curry, the spice, wasn't even necessary.
Nope. It was just some horse shit. Oh my god. Okay. The elephants are quite possibly one of the greatest fucking running gags I've ever seen. It's so funny every fucking time. And it just gets crazier and crazier. Like, there's a herd of elephants fucking surfing a wave in the ocean. That was the one I was thinking of.
It's fucking great.
Surfing. They're hanging 10. They're fucking catching a sick wave. And it's just elephant sound effect dot wav. And just...
It's also the headcanon of the fact that this specific herd of elephants has it out specifically for Nanami. Like, they are just devoted to hunting this girl down.
Nanami goes through so much shit in this series, man. Like,
he goes through so much shit, most of it she deserves, but then she gets all the best comedy episodes.
I mean, she deserves it to an extent, but at the same time, like, at some point you just feel kind of bad. You just kind of feel bad for her, man.
Part of this, I have to clarify. I am not a huge fan of Nanami as a character, which I will get into later. However, damn if they didn't give her the best comedic shit every fucking time.
I think it's because they knew that Nanami was kind of a bitch. Let's make her a funny bitch. Let's make her, like, exceptionally hilarious.
Let's give her all the good gags.
Yeah, because hey, asshole characters are hilarious. Asshole characters are funny. And if you treat them like shit throughout your show, they're going to be even funnier.
Mm-hmm. That's just guaranteed comedy right there.
Exactly.
But it totally works because she's such a fucking Ojo-sama. She's such a... she does the Ojo-sama laugh. And it's just... I'm like, God, you are such a spoiled princess that I want to see... Oh, elephants. Okay, I'm down.
I swear, those elephants killed me. Every fucking time, dude.
The fucking, God, what was it? Me Cow Dior Cowbell?
Yeah.
Forgot about that.
Episode 16. She's like, yeah, I got this Michael Dior, like, fancy bell. Turns out it was my cow Dior, and then she turns into a cow.
Can you imagine? Can you imagine if you were gifted a cowbell and it just turned you into a cow?
She's an animorph. She turned into a fucking animorph.
I turned myself into an egg cow.
She doesn't lay an egg, but she lays an egg.
Yeah,
into a cow, Utena. Funniest shit I've ever seen.
Ever seen.
Spencer, what's your favorite episode?
I'm going to give it to episode 19, The Song of the Fallen Kingdom.
Ooh, that's a good one.
That is the Wakaba Tatsuya episode. First off, I love Wakaba. She is, once again, the kind of Genki energy that I love, because she's just this bubbly, like Wakaba, like, if you want to find out what kind of Genki energy, aka, like, energetic energy that I like, you'll look at, like, Kill la Kill has Mako. She's my favorite character. She's Genki as fuck. Wakaba is one of my favorites. She's Genki as fuck. The difference that they're not annoying. They're treated as, like, a fun character instead of, like, that's their only personality trait. Looking at you, fucking Uzaki. But 19 is great because we get backstory on Wakaba and how she has this onion prince, as she called him, and Tatsuya wants to get in on Utena, and Utena's like, shut the fuck up, I'm not interested in you, I'm not interested in anybody, I'm a prince. And then it turns out, oh, Tatsuya is in love with Wakaba. That's really nice. And Utena tries to get them together. And then Wakaba is still in love with Reiki? No.
Mm-hmm.
The green-haired guy? What was his
name? Sionji.
Sionji, that's it. Sionji. So then he goes to the Black Rose Society. He goes to the Mikage seminar. And the best part of the episode is he like spills his guts. You think it's gonna be like everything else, it's gonna end with a duel, but Professor Nemuro is just like, you're not worth my time, basically. Like,
be gone, simp.
Shut the fuck up, you are not worth gifting a rose to. And I'm like, yeah, fuck that guy.
Yeah, goodbye.
Goodbye. I forget the actual quote, but he's just like, nah, get the fuck out. Fuck off.
That episode's really, really great. I love any episode in this series that like really just dives into these characters. I give it to the finale. Someday We Will Shine Together, episode 39. Mainly because as a finale, this is one of my favorite anime finales in general. I think what they pull off here is something. It's like a really, it's a balancing act they gotta pull off, because leading up to this, they pretty much like turn the entire series on their head in terms of just like kind of what you would expect. Certain revelations happen involving Akio and Anthy and stuff that you realize how like Utena kind of fell into like this pretty basically this fucking game. What I love about this finale is that it fully leans into the surrealism and its ambiguity. What do you want to make of the finale is up to you. And that is the important, like what I like. And the big thing to me about like what I mostly just take away from it is the fact that is kind of me, like what I, it ties into adolescence to an extent. And we'll talk about adolescence quite a bit more in a bit. What I take away from this finale is so something a little bit tragic is the fact if you see Utena the entire series as just one giant internal deconstruction and look, or just like in like symbolic look into what is essentially a queer romance. This end of the show is basically like, it's just like fucking just like Japanese society will never let these two people be together because they suck. And I think that's it's suddenly the world crashing down on these characters like as quickly as it was left lifted up. And while in the ending is hopeful and does have the element of one, like, someday we will shine together, there is that element of tragedy there that I really love. Also, it's storyboarded by Mamoru fucking Hosoda.
I just found that out as you were talking, and I didn't want to interrupt you, but holy shit.
He was on this show in a good... Yeah, Mamoru Hosoda did a lot of this show. He also storyboarded Elements of Adolescence. And once you realize that he worked on this show, you can't unsee it now.
Nope, yep.
Mm-hmm. You can't. His style is everywhere in this. Now you know also why I love Utena so much, because fucking Hosoda. And I love Hosoda. So it's... but, like, I love that finale. I think it's great. Also, on the note of, you mentioned arcs, the reason why the arc structure works so well is because Ikuhara was the director on Sailor Moon for, like, three seasons. So yeah. He knows how arc-based stuff works. And he's really able to tap into that. Let's talk about characters. Shane, who's your favorite character from Utena?
I mean, is it really a question?
I mean, I am asking, so yes, it is a question.
Oh, okay. Okay, fair enough. It's Utena.
It's Utena, which is mine too. Utena's my favorite. Utena. Yeah. Utena's my favorite as well.
Goddamn, man. She's just great. And she's such a great deconstruction of the stereotypical shoujo protagonist. And also a great vehicle in which to examine, like, gender norms and sexuality and stuff like that.
Yeah, even just gender in general. I know a lot. I know that Utena is kind of a trans icon in a lot of circles, and it makes sense. It absolutely makes sense. And and one thing I love about Utena as a character is the fact that she's I love characters who are like characters like Utena, who is this kind of like standard shoujo protagonist who's always like wants to do the right thing and is super friendly and just like the kid, like a good person, and is placed in a world that's just really complicated and dark and like and much more than just that, and seeing her trying to navigate that and retain that optimism and that friendly and like that good-hearted nature that she is, and I love that. It's the good shit. Okay, you can go ahead. I'm sorry for interrupting.
I mean, all I was gonna say on top of what I already said is that, man, I love characters that are like, yeah, I know I'm like a girl or a guy or whatever, but I can be whatever the fuck I want to be, and no one can tell me otherwise. I love that so much, man.
Yeah, you go, girl.
You go, girl. You do you. You rock that fucking uniform.
Yeah, she looks good. She looks real good.
Damn good. She got that drip, bro.
Yeah, she's got drip throughout this. Honestly, the drip in this show is immaculate. Yeah. But Spencer, who's your favorite character?
Is he even back yet? No, he is not, apparently.
He is not. Okay. We'll move on.
That is crazy.
We'll talk about our least favorites then before he comes back. Then we can keep this moving. Shane, who's your least favorite by extension?
Man, so this is actually difficult because there's several characters in this show that I could fucking drag through the mud. Spencer's back, so.
Before we get to worse, then Spencer, who's your favorite character?
What did you guys pick?
Utena.
I also picked Utena.
Good.
She is what we in the LGBT call a bicon. She's genuinely the first bisexual character I think I've seen in anime that I can remember.
And she's the first openly one.
Yeah, openly one.
From 97 as well? Holy shit. Like,
yeah.
From the dark ages.
That's really impressive. Because even in 2022, being bisexual is kind of a questionable sexuality, to say the least.
Yeah. But like Utena, I love how the show is just like, yeah, Utena likes boys and girls.
And that's totally okay. Deal with it, bitches. But no, I find her character to be really fun. She fits in the same kind of weird area as, like, Camille Bidon, in which they're just 110% fed up with everybody's bullshit, and I love it.
Yeah.
I live for Utena's, like, just absolute disregard for Toru's playboy bullshit. Creepy-ass motherfucker. But also the fact that she's just like, why am I fighting you? I don't want to fight you. Stop it. And they're just like, no, I have to do this because, you know, I've been talked into this because we need a plot. And she's just like, fine. And then she beats them and it's just like, okay, now grow the fuck up. Bye. The best character.
Yeah. Alright. Now on to least favorites. Shane.
Okay, like I was saying, this is difficult because there are several candidates in my mind. But you know what? Looking back on it, I think I can't in good conscience not pick. I had a brain fart there.
I could tell you having a brain fart because you were like,
I felt the cogs just grind to a halt.
I could feel the dead air. Does he want me to stall for time? Like,
I knew exactly what I was gonna say too, and then it just didn't come out, which is the worst part. God, someone get me a new brain. But I can't in good conscience not pick the character who is into incest. So it's Akio.
Incense is a bit different than incest, buddy.
Yeah.
If somebody is into incense, that's fine.
No, that's fine. They're just going to church. Person. Yeah.
You're just going to church, my dude.
Yeah,
at that
my point. Dude.
But yeah, it's Akio. He's fucking creepy. Creepo, weirdo.
He's mine, too, because Akio is a fucking... okay. Akio is... Well, he's not just into that. He's also a rapist.
A womanizer.
He is genuinely one of the most detestable characters in anime when you really get down to it. He's just a fucking dickhead. He is basically as described by Ikuhara himself, the patriarchy in human form.
Man is a manipulator. Man is a womanizer. Man is a rapist.
Man manipulates. Mansplains. Man wife.
Man male fucking wife. Roofies his sister's drink. It's fun.
Exactly. Like, describing it's like, icky.
I hate it.
Man gets so upset that he couldn't sexually assault his unconscious, but kind of conscious sister that he falls out a window and kills himself.
That scene's wild, dude.
In the movie, yeah, that shit's
that's
wild.
In the movie. That's in the movie.
Yeah, we'll talk about the movie. I have so much to say
In the TV show, however, by the way, I also agree. Akio, aside from just being a power-hungry, maniacal douchebag, he plays with my girl Utena, plays with her heart, man, and that ain't cool.
Yeah, because cool. He was. I love the twist though that he's the prince that gave her the fucking ring in the first place. I think that's a really clever twist.
It's a good ass twist, but I'm also like, dude, there's only like two brown people in this entire show.
Whoa!
I wonder who it is.
Whoa! Okay. Oh, he's not wrong. He's not wrong. He's not wrong. Out of context, that sounds bad, but like it's also not wrong.
In context, they are all white little European cherubs, and there's Anthy and Akio, and those are the only two people that have relative skin color.
Okay. I mean, yeah, you're not wrong, but also
I'm not wrong.
Maybe worded.
It just sounds really funny. Out of context, it sounds really funny.
I'm gonna get canceled on fucking Twitter.
Yeah, it's time, boys.
I knew you guys have wanted to cancel me for a long time, okay?
It's time, make the call out, Bozo. Make it.
But yeah, Akio sucks. Fuck him.
Yeah. Yeah. Guys, yeah,
fuck that Bozo.
Stinky. You know what I mean? Like, guys, just a stink pot.
He's the guy that if you saw, like, walking down the street towards you, you'd run in the opposite direction.
You don't interact with him. Don't look at him. Don't breathe in his general direction.
Just stay away from me and just don't look at him.
He's
a freak.
He is the guy who takes Super Seducer like literally.
He probably watches Andrew Tate.
He 100% is a supporter of Andrew Tate. He 100%. This man quotes. This man quotes Ben Shapiro to his like rape victims.
Do you think he runs a pickup course online?
He doesn't just run it. He is the pickup
course. Yeah, he is the pickup course. You have to pick him up in your 1987 Cadillac, in which he will screw you in the back and then leave you. Okay, man. Right. He's just that cool. He has sunglasses on.
Listen, fellow men, listen here. You're going to want to watch me. I'm going to show you exactly how you get the ladies. First off, you lean in on them. You get dangerously close, like blatantly disregarding their personal space and be like, hey, baby, you want me to buy you a drink? And if she says, ew, please leave me alone, that's when you slip it in.
Yeah, yeah.
I made myself.
What do you mean, officer?
No, I could tell Shane is saying that was just kind of like fucking like that.
I'm wanted for 27 counts of aggravated sexual harassment. What do you mean?
All right. It's time we move on.
Yeah, okay, let's talk about the rest of the show. I want to talk about the score because people have mentioned it before.
Yay, fucking Salazar, dude.
Ooh, oh boy. So like. It rules. Like, the music in this show is...
Way to use fucking vocal themes, dude.
You can now tell where the fucking inspiration for Revue Starlight came from.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is... Dude, his actual name is Takaki Terahara, known professionally as Julius Arnest J.A. Caesar, is a Japanese film and theater music composer. He does the guy's the best, okay? Fucking every single like vocal track in this entire show whips.
Mm-hmm.
So hard.
Yeah, and that's not it. And and the actual like the vocal tracks are great. I love the actual music to the show is insanely good. He also did the guy who did the music for this, his name is Shinkichi Mitsune. He also did another one of my all-time favorite soundtracks. He helped the Pillows on FLCL. He was in the he did a lot of the instrumental stuff for that show.
I see.
He also did the music for Family of Zero, of all things, which I remember actually had really good music.
That was like one of the best parts of that show.
Yeah. So, and he also did the music to he did the music to Rosen Maiden, which is another really great show. I think the reason why I love the music to this show so much is that it's very classical.
Speedgrapher.
Yeah. It leans the music in the show leans very hard into it being again like a classic shoujo. So it's got very traditional music in a lot of like almost classical music in it. That sounds like it, and it sounds really great. And I love that kind of music in a show like this, and it feels very baroque. And it's perfect. Perfect stuff. Also, the OP is really good, too.
OP is really good.
And ED fucking win.
And ED, both of them are great. Both the EDs. The OP doesn't change, but the ED changes. What I like also about the music is that aside from Absolute Destiny Apocalypse playing every single time, which that track rules, by the way, but there's different arrangements depending on which arc they're in. The music that plays when Utena takes the sword of, I forget what the actual name of the sword is, but takes the sword out of Anthy, changes depending on the arc. And the original, the first arc, the Student Council saga, the music that plays reminds me a lot of the band Enigma, because it's like this kind of, it's this low kind of jazz drum beat to it, and it's just like, ooh, this is nice. And then I watched it, and I'm just like, yo, the music in this show rules. And sure, most of the actual, like duel, like, songs, vocal arrangements are, like, word nonsense that has a little bit of theming to it.
It doesn't make it any less incredible that that this choir is kicking ass and taking names.
Yeah, it's some good shit. The other thing I wanted to discuss is just the animation and the art in this show in general.
Yo, this is JC staff.
Yeah, this is JC staff. Super early on in their career. If you're wondering, up to this point, JC staff had like not done much. They had been around since the 80s, but they had been mostly doing in between work. The first show they did as like an actual show was called Wowzer in 1988, and it was a co-production, and it was even a co-production. It wasn't even all their thing. If we're talking about shows that they would done by themselves, Utena was the fourth show they did.
That's really impressive.
It was the fourth show. This was early on in their life, and it was also their first like actual hit. It was like the first one that really made a big name, because a year later they would do Katekano with Gainax, which was Hideki Anno's show that they did with him. And of course that's how they got going. And then the year later, Excel Saga. So that's how they kind of got going. It was because of this Utena. It was because of Utena, Katekano, and Excel Saga. And one thing I love about this show is that, yes, the show was clearly Ikuhara has talked about it at length. It was very clearly made with a lot of budgetary constraints.
Yes.
He made it with a lot. He didn't have a lot of funding for it because it was a risky endeavor, and it was based, and it was kind of, it was basically an anime original. But Ikuhara pretty much, having worked on Sailor Moon, so he knows how he handles how to work within a budget. He used that to his advantage, and the cinematography in this show. As a film student, this show just gets better every time I watch it, because I'm just kind of like, I'm just like in awe of just how beautiful it looks, how every shot is composed. So many the uses of shadows and the and just framing and just like a lot of really dynamic poses. It's just
a lot of silhouettes too, a lot of like really striking silhouettes.
Yeah, a lot of striking silhouette, a lot of it too. Like
a lot of really great wide shots. Like, I know you posted the one of the castle, which is the the big one, but there's a lot of that kind of stuff, and it dispersed throughout.
Yeah, and it looks wonderful with the background.
Are those hand painted?
A lot of this is. This show was made in the era where everything was still like actually hand drawn. And because of that, a lot of the really impressive stuff really stands out. Like, it looks really good. And I what I also like too is the fact that the animation is like, they did have a lot of, but the actual animation itself isn't bad. It's definitely got that, it's a little dated, but I like the fact that it is as good as it is with character designs as kind of specific as this show. Mm-hmm. And that makes it really unique to me. I especially love how a lot of the fight scenes are edited and done. It's very it's very, very good stuff across the board with this.
In a weird way, watching this show finally has made me appreciate Revue Starlight even more.
Yep.
Because
Revue Starlight took what this show did and kind of like built on it.
It gave it more money is what it did.
Yeah, definitely.
And that was the big thing, is if this would have came out today with the amount of budget it probably would have gotten, like, this would have looked gorgeous. However, as much as I talk as I told Matt, I'm like, oh, man, they really like reusing shots.
Yep, there's a lot of reused animation here.
That was never meant as a negative thing or a bad thing because they make it work so well.
Yeah, like it's honestly one of the better instances of reused animation. Mm-hmm. Also because the specific instances where they do reuse it, it matches with, you know, what's happening at that point in time. And a lot of it is reused in the duels, which is like the big culminating parts of the show where a lot of character arcs and a lot of the themes tend to be resolved. So it makes sense.
Yeah. And obviously the transformation sequences are like the big ones that are reused. But like, I've seen a lot of Magical Girl stuff. I've seen far worse reused animations for fucking Magical Girl. Even Madoka Magica has reused animation for its transformation sequences. Like, and that show looks insane. So like, it's a common trope in Magical Girl shows that you just kind of expect. And one thing I love about Utena's is that the actual transformation sequence is so good that it doesn't matter. Like, this is a top-tier transformation sequence, one of the best in the entire genre. So of course you want to see it multiple times, because it's just rad as shit. It's great.
And also, it's not reused to the point where it becomes redundant, because it changes every arc.
Yeah, it does change every arc. And so, like, and it changes every arc. So when you see the new one, you're like, let's fucking go. Like, you're really excited.
You've seen the old one just enough, and they've reused it just enough to where you're like, okay, I get it. And then you're right on the cusp of wanting them to do something new. And guess what? They fucking do it. They fucking do it.
Yeah. And I think that's kind of another thing that works is, like, I could have 100% skipped those transformation scenes to, you know, save on time. But aside from the fact that they looked really good and the music that went with the transformation scenes, I'm like, oh, I can't skip this. I got to learn about people's marriage records and birth records and death dates and shining light inside of an infinite darkness. And then Onthi's going to turn into a tree.
True that. Like, anything else anyone wants to talk about? Good, bad, negatives, positives?
I think I've hit everything I wanted to talk about.
Show is confusing, but I loved it.
Yeah. All right. Before we get into final scores, let's move on. I want to talk about Adolescence. Because we all watched Adolescence because I felt that it was an important... Adolescence is kind of an integral part to the whole thing in a weird way. Because it is a... It is a bizarro movie. It is a bizarro movie. Because it was... It's not a sequel, but it's also not a remake. It's also not a recap. It's kind of like all of them at once. I want to know what you think, Shane, because this is like a whole thing.
I got two things to say. First off, going off of what you were saying, trying to describe this, I consider this to be the rebuild of Utena. Because in its format, in its structure, in the way that it's very loosely a retelling, but not really, and then it's its own beast entirely, it very much is. It very much plays to that kind of storytelling a lot. Second, Matt, what the fuck is this movie?
An incredible piece of cinema. That's what it is. It is. So, like, one thing I love about this movie, and I'll get more into it in a second, is the fact that it's Ikuhara Unleashed. This, my friends, is Ikuhara. This is Ikuhara. Like,
the man at his full power.
You were not. Were you ready for the man at his full power?
I can't say I was.
Spencer, what did you think of Adolescence of Utena? Because I'm very curious.
So I understand why people call it End of Uta. because Jesus. Fucking him and wait, no, because End of Eva came out in 99, didn't it?
97.
97? Okay.
This was 99.
Okay. So, yeah, no, I can totally see that. This man unhinged. Ikuhara is unhinged, is how I would politely put it. This is the most confusing movie to place words about how I would describe it. Because it's basically like an... It's basically like if you take Ava's style of, like, loops and make it about Utena. Because all the things happened, kind of, but there's also major changes, but things line up in a way that, like, you're learning things about the anime from the movie. Even though mm-hmm. the movie's telling a completely different story, but similar story, like the thing that I'll go to is the whole thing with Toru. Okay?
Toru. Toga.
I was going to mention that too, Spencer, because that was where I was like, okay, this is clearly its own beast. Because as soon as she recognized Toga, I was like, wait a sec. Is it linking back to the show? And then it's like, no, they were actually dating. So it's like a different backstory. It's like, what was happening?
Yeah, but it's not just that. It's, if you remember, and I'll let Matt talk about it first before I go more into detail. So
because Toga's backstory in adolescence is completely different mm-hmm. than in the show. And this relates back to kind of what Ikuhara wanted to do with adolescence, because he developed the movie as a film that was strictly meant to heighten the themes of the show, to do what he couldn't do in the show. Basically, he wanted sex. That's what he wanted. And we'll get into that. But one of the big things is that Toga's backstory was heavily much more of a big part of adolescence, even though it was actually going to be part of the show. The reason why his backstory wasn't in the show was because the actor got ill. The actor was unavailable for health reasons, so they had to cut it out and replace it with other things. Now they could actually just explore his backstory and do what they were originally planning to do. So his backstory, to an extent, would have been the same in both, which adds up. Because if you watch this movie afterwards, it explains a lot about Toga in both versions, I'd argue. It explains a lot about him, as a person. But go ahead, Spencer, and you can talk about it.
Okay, so the thing, though, and it's not that. It's that's true when you realize, oh, they're dated. It's not that. If you remember, okay, in the show, Juri mentioned that she was saved by a young boy mm-hmm. after she had fallen out of her boat and the young boy died.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember that happening, and that does track.
Mm-hmm. And it tracks, even though this is supposed to be something completely different. But at the end, when it's like, oh shit, Toga's been dead the entire time, Uchida just needed to accept that. And then Utsuda moves forward with her lesbian lover, Onthi, and then she turns into a car.
So, Utsuda turns into a fucking car?
She gets eaten by a car wash and then turned into a car.
Yeah, it's okay. Okay, yeah, so the car thing is maybe, unfortunately, the only thing that people actually remember, ever reference Utsuda for.
I'm sorry, but do you blame me?
I don't blame you. I don't. Because out of context, it is so funny to talk about that she turned into a car. It leads to, like, an incredible action scene, though. So, guys, like, I'm not complaining.
Okay. Yeah, I need to find it. Because when I watched that for the first time, and then Shiori shows up as a car, too, and the line she fucking says.
Yeah, I could be a car or something like that.
Hold on, I'm looking for it. You guys continue. Oh, here, I found it. The line is, if you thought you were the only one who could turn into a car, then you're sorely mistaken. That's right. I'm a car now, too. That is real dialogue that a human wrote.
But, like, it's Kino. Like, this is actually Kino. Which, by the way, there's an entire fucking... One of the things I love is that entire sequence, by the way, according to... This is what Ikuhara said to describe about it. Make of this what you will. He has described the scene in the context of the film's subversion of Utena and Anthe's relationship roles. There's the story of Sleeping Beauty, or you have the princess who'd been asleep for a long time who's awakened by the prince. But the Utena character has been the prince from the beginning of the story. So the idea of Utena being turned into a car suggests that she is being put to sleep. I thought it would be interesting to reverse the roles played by Utena and Anthony in their respective relationships. In other words, Utena is the one who ends up becoming the princess. She's the one forced into sleep, and only Anthony can free Utena from this sleep. That's how things come to an end. I thought it would be very interesting to reverse their roles. That is what he said about that. So, make that what you will.
I mean, it makes sense. Given that he calls it a subversion, because, yeah, the entire time, Utena is the one playing the prince, the hero, the one who's there to protect Anthe and is always at her side. And then in the end, it's Anthe who's the one who sets her free. She's the one who takes the lead and is the one who basically enacts the climax of the movie.
Yeah.
And then the two of them, butt-ass naked, drive off into the sunset at the end.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because now they can be lesbians together.
They've reached that other world, a.k.a. outside of Japan.
But yeah, don't forget. That is straight up, Shane, you joke, but that's actually what it
no,
is.
No. Ikuhara, I was being 100% serious. I was not joking.
Ikuhara is like, yeah, no, they're straight up like leaving Japan, bro.
They're leaving Japan because they won't let them be lesbians.
They're like, leaving Japan into this hellscape, which is obviously everything outside of Japan.
Yeah, fucking.
I also love that the fucking student council is like, hey, take this overpass. Yeah, don't worry, we'll get out of here eventually. See you later, fucker.
And then they take the wrong exit.
And then they take the wrong exit because they can't escape yet. And this brings me to my favorite characters, probably like ever of this specific type, is the fucking Greek choir. The Shadow Girls are the best. Okay.
Oh yeah, I'm very surprised we haven't talked about them yet.
There's a lot going on there.
Through the entire show and the movie, I'm like, are they real? Can people see them? Do they exist?
And the answer, and yes, they are the drama club.
Yeah.
But also, they're in like a nebulous position because they're a drama club, but they know more than they think. And then sometimes they're normally ignored, except for when you get into the Black Rose stuff, where people start to respond like a call and response thing. And it's their point, and it's their job to like summarize every episode through these little shadow puppets. And I'm like, holy shit, these characters are fascinating, but
what?
God.
What if they're omnipotent beings? What if they're just the gods of this universe?
Maybe. If that's what you want to interpret from
them. That's what you want to interpret.
The other thing I want to bring up for adolescence is that the animation in this movie is nuts. It is
insane.
Mm-hmm. Bonkos.
This movie was released on 35mm.
That's tell why you everything it looks so good.
It was released on 35mm and was actually one of the first anime movies to use both traditional and cel animation in the same movie. It was made with a mix of both. And he actually, and And what's interesting is that Ikuhara specifically got animators who worked on mecha anime to work on the final car chase. Did not work. Mm-hmm. Yeah, to the point where he was asking people who normally work on mecha anime to work on it. To the fact that some people refused because they were wondering, why the fuck do you need me on Utena? Like, why do you want me to work on?
She turns into a car.
Yeah. Also, this is one of the few anime films that wasn't storyboarded from start to finish. What they did was they gave one animator a fifth of the film and had them storyboard it themselves.
That's fucking nutty.
This movie was made by a madman.
This movie was made by an insane person.
This movie was made by an insane person who has also cosplayed as Sailor Mars at his own conventions.
Yep.
Ikuhara is great because he's a Fujimoto level, just like crazy, like insane.
Has he tried to levitate?
I don't think so, but he changed his name briefly to Bonsoir Ikuhara.
That is true. He did. I do remember that. He did briefly change his name to Bonsoir Ikuhara. So not quite levitating, but...
Yeah, guess what person Ikuhara wants to work with the most? Just guess.
Fucking... Darren Aronofsky.
No. Just guess. Because when you hear it, you're going to be like, of course.
That means it's a fucking sicko.
It's David Lynch.
Yep, it's a sicko. Yep. Packing up, boys.
I was going to say, if it wasn't Aronofsky, it was 100% Lynch.
And I'm just like, which, you know what? God, man's got good taste.
Make it happen.
A fellow Kino connoisseur, I see.
I see.
Yeah, but let's final scores. Let's go on to final scores, because I think we're done here. Shane, what do you give Revolutionary Girl Utena? And also, you can give a score for Adolescence of Utena, if you so desire as well.
I give overall, the whole thing, both of them, 10. Mm-hmm.
Hell yeah.
Like, do I have to say anything else? It's fucking weird. It's out there. It's experimental. It's made by a literal insane person. And you can derive whatever meaning you want from it. And frankly, I appreciate that. I like shows and media that are just like templates for you to figure out whatever the hell you want from it. It can mean anything to you and it will probably work because it's just that versatile. Love that shit. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, it's really fucking well made, so
yeah. Spencer, what do you give
Revolution? Overall, I shall give it a 10 out of 10. This show is wacky, this show is confusing, this show is iconic. It is not for everybody. There are a wide majority of people that will not like this show, but I'm rating it not them, and I give it a 10 because the show rules.
Yeah, fuck them.
Yeah, fuck them in particular.
You know what Matt's gonna give it?
Yeah, it's a fucking 11, bro. Got the 11 out of 10 because this is my top 10 anime of all time. I love this show. I have seen it more than you guys, so I have more of a understanding of this kind of like just like I know it. Much more distinctly. I've seen it 3 times, and trust me when I say that it gets better every time you watch it. It's one of those shows where
100% that kind of show.
Where if you rewatch it, it's going to go up in your ranking. It is 100% going to go up in your ranking, and you're going to and it's a long show, so it's not one I rewatch constantly because obviously not because I don't want to. I do. It's just, you know, it's a time consumer. You have to really you sit down to actually watch it, but like it's fantastic, and I think it's a classic of the genre, and I would argue a must-watch for any anime fan. Even if you're not into this kind of stuff, I feel like it's an important one to the medium, and you should do yourselves a favor and check it out. Like, it is... It's an important one, and it's got some spectacular... And if you're even remotely interested in just anime beyond, like, shonen anime, or, like, the standard mainstream stuff, go watch Utena, because that'll give you... That will... I want you to understand that Utena, like, I had seen Ava already and a couple of other ones, so I had already experienced it. I think Utena was, like, my first, like, avant-garde thing I ever watched. So imagine, you can only imagine just kind of, like, my brain melting the first time watching this. But I love this show, and it's, and everything about it. So with that, let's move on to... our next featured anime of the podcast. If you don't know how this works, we rotate every time between a pick from me and Shane and the randomizer. Utena was a meta on the randomizer, so we're moving on to a pick from me and Shane, and it is my turn to pick. So what are we doing? Well, we're doing a show that I have been wanting to cover for so long. We talk about this studio a lot, and we talk about this director a lot. We actually just talked about him this podcast during simulcasts. And it's a perfect time to cover it, because this is a show that I've been just meaning to cover for. I was like, fuck it, bite the bullet and just fucking finally do it. Next time on the podcast, we're going to be covering the... Is it 2013? It's 2013, right?
2013, yeah.
Okay. I need to make sure... It blurs together. The 2013 anime, Kill la Kill, known as KLK, Kill la Bill, whatever you want to fucking call it, from Studio Trigger, the Studio Trigger, also known as, and Studio Trigger's first ever show, the show that catapulted them into stardom. So we're gonna be covering that next time on the podcast. If you thought Utena was nutty, you probably Kill la Kill's not as nutty as Utena. It's still pretty nutty, I'd argue. Like, it's still pretty, like, out there. So we'll see. And also technically a magical girl show.
Mm-hmm.
If you actually get down to it.
Yeah. I guess.
Well, no, it's classified as one. It's classified as one. Imashi said that Kill la Kill is supposed to be what he wants wanted the magical girl series to be, which I'm like, okay. I guess. Well, next time we'll be covering that. I'm your host, Matt, aka Legion Rex. You can find me on YouTube at Legion Rex, as well as on Twitter at Legion Rex. When I stream on Twitch every once in a blue moon. With me, I also have my co-host, Shane, aka the Bearded One. You can find him on YouTube. On Twitter at Bearded Gaming Network, as well as on YouTube on Bearded Gaming Network, where he posts podcasts, Let's Plays, gameplay videos, unboxings, a bunch of other stuff. He's actually uploading again. Who knew? He's not dead.
I haven't been dead for a while. It's crazy.
Yeah. So hopefully this continues a trend and he starts uploading again. You can also find him on Twitch at Bearded Gaming Network, where he streams every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 7 to 10. And I don't know exactly what... I think this is probably going to go up Wednesday morning.
Wednesday morning, yeah. So, tonight... Oh, boy.
Tonight, the stream is just Majima versus Saijima, because I don't know how long it's going to be before he beats that on hard, because he fought Majima at the end of the last stream and got absolutely annihilated. He didn't even get to Saijima. All he got was to the doppelganger. He got to the doppelgangers, and that's it. And they fucking just wiped the floor with him.
Okay, but here's the put
on his big brain.
Here's the thing, though. I've been doing grinding off screen. I'm almost done business management, so I have Eerie, and I almost have Orbital Laser.
Okay, so just get Orbital Laser. I will say this, Orbital Laser probably ain't going to do shit. It doesn't do much against them. So it'll help with the doppelgangers. Honestly, those are actually a bigger problem than either Majima or Saijima, I'd argue, actually. Yes. When it's just Majima by himself, he's not actually that bad. He just deals a lot of damage. If you have a good healer, you can deal with that.
These motherfucking grape juice bitches.
Yeah, but in any case, with me, I also have my co-host Spencer. You can find him on Twitter at Beery Burton with two E's.
Two E's.
And where he is the official fan page for the Cincinnati Bengals. Or is it just the Toronto Blue Jays?
It hasn't been like that for weeks, dude. You said it last time.
I'm actually neither. Forgetting
shit, Ed. I'm so used to it now.
I'm actually neither. I like in RT cosplays and shitposts. I also watch my sports teams lose.
Damn.
You know,
man's depressed.
You can find me Banjo 2E's in a little bear and a bird emoji. And also, did you know that my father was killed by a devil orange tree named Jim Jim John?
So sad.
At this
so
point,
tragic.
I feel sad, and sweet apples falling from the fuck tree are dead.
I always forget that that's your fucking pin.
It's such a tragic backstory, dude.
Apples falling from the fuck tree are dead is probably my favorite part of that.
We'll see you next time for Kill a Fucking Kill.
Yeah, bye. Thank you for listening to The Gap. If you like what you've seen, you can subscribe to The Gap Podcast YouTube channel to get the latest podcasts as they go live. Be sure to like and comment and let us know what you guys think of the show. Thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.